So welcome, we would be talking about some of the key highlights from this edition of DTE. And the first thing that we need to understand is the new normal. Now the new normal talks about a hybrid workspace, which is an amalgamation of offline plus online modes. So there would be differences in the kind of office plans that come up. So the kind of social functions, rentals would significantly reduce. Also, we have seen that this would lead to a serious impact on the economy. Indian economy declined, the GDP declined by 23.9% in this quarter, and it makes it a significant marker for the coming economic issues that could be there. So what happened if we go back to the various models? In 1990s, when there was a recession in Americas, George Bush, the president at that time, tried to come up to the streets and urge people to buy more, consume more, increase the domestic demand. And the same is happening with China as of now. When the exports have been curtailed, the imports are being, the internal consumption is being thrust. So the idea is to focus on more spread of the economic potential within the nation. And therefore, within India, we are now focusing on Make in India, where we are talking about industries coming in India, meeting the basic requirements of the people of India. Again, with this new normal, we have seen a change in the lifestyle that could be seen. So this includes masks and sanitizers. Now, sanitizers are mainly made up of ethanol. However, in many of the cases, we have seen adulteration, and the adulteration is of methanol. Now, methanol does not come under the liquor tax, and therefore, significant proportions of unnamed sanitizers are coming up with the composition of methanol, which is detrimental to health. And therefore, it's very, very important to know the ingredients of the sanitizer before you go for it. Also, we need to understand that hydrogen peroxide, isopropyl alcohol, glycerol, ethanol are some of the common ingredients of a good sanitizer. Now, coming on to next important topic is vultures. Vultures have been in the history of India since ancient times of Ramayana, when we have talked about Jatayu, who was considered as the king of vultures, and he sacrificed his life when the abduction of Sita took place. Now, similarly, we have seen vultures to be an essential part of the ecosystem, we could say. We have, over the past 20 years, witnessed that nearly 40 million vultures have died, and this is due to higher proportion of diclofenac, which is found in the cattle. Now, when the carcasses of these cattle is being consumed by vultures, it enters into the body of vulture and leads to kidney failure or renal failure, and therefore has become a major issue. So the population of vultures is significantly declining, and if it continues, they would be on the verge of extinction. Similarly, there was another recent discovery on gravitational waves, where two gigantic black holes weighing nearly 85 and 66 times of the mass of the sun headed towards a collision, and this was detected as a formation that led to a formation of black hole, which is nearly 150 times the mass of the sun. And this was done by the Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory and the efforts of the Virgo. Now, the next important news that comes in is the higher amount of suicides in the farming community. Over the past 5 years, we have seen a significant increase in the number of suicide. Now, this suicide rate has significantly increased during the last few months, with the daily wage earners, that is one in every four, and 7% of those have been done by people involved in farming. Now, the states with the highest proportion are Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh and Telangana, which accounts for nearly 83% of the deaths, and 86% of the farmers are those who are small and landless farmers. Now, if we focus on to another important study, is on the mass extinction. It was believed that 66 million years ago, when dinosaurs went extinct, it was due to an asteroid that hit the Earth. Similarly, 359 million years ago, there was an extinction that occurred between the Devonian and the Carboniferous period. And this is, the studies as of now believe that this is due to the thinning of the ozone layer due to the ultraviolet rays exposure that has been seen. Similarly, the mass extinction between the Permian and the Triassic period was due to volcanic eruption, which ultimately led to climate change and destruction of the ozone. And late Devonian period, we have seen a significant extinction of the armored freshwater fishes. However, the bony fishes and the sharks survived. Now, this is very, very important. We have seen that during the late Devonian period, there has been the extinction of the tetrapods that have been seen. Also, the fish whose fin had evolved as limbs between 6 to 8 fingers or toes were the ones that were affected. The studies have revealed that there was resistant wall on the microscopic pollens that was seen, and this was the study taken from the regions of eastern Greenland as of now. The samples were still seen in the rock samples of eastern Greenland, and it was believed that there was a kind of brief interval where you had the formation of new cell that took place and a protective wall that was formed. Most of the spines that were seen were vulnerable because they were malformed and their DNA was significantly damaged due to ultraviolet rays, and this proved that there was thinning of the ozone during that time that led to ultraviolet rays, and this led to the destruction of most of the species that was there. Also, we have seen a significant link between global warming and atmospheric transportation. Chlorine bearing compounds were seen. Now, this chlorine bearing compounds were exposed to the atmosphere, the upper atmosphere. They combined with oxygen to form chlorine oxide, and as a result, you had oxygen radicals that were combining with chlorine, leading to thinning of the ozone, the same phenomena that we are witnessing today. So that could be one of the probable reasons for another mass extinction that could be seen. Now, farmers are essential part of Indian economy. As we already know, 86% of the households account for small and landless farmers, with nearly 48% of the land. Now, 69% of the population in rural area have agriculture as their staple source of income. The monthly income was around 8,000, and there should be an inflationary rate, if we believe, a kind of around 9.5% annually. Now, what has happened this time during the lockdown period was that the crop seasons that were seen have not witness that much demand. As a result, farmers do not have excess money for the next season. So there has been a kind of disruption in the Kharif and the Rabi cropping seasons, and farmers do not have adequate disposable income to invest for the next season. Also, we have seen there are three major policies that have come up recently. Those are farm loans, agriculture credit, crop insurance, and minimum support system. Also, we have seen, if we talk about history, we have a significant increase in the GDP being derived from agriculture. During the independence, it was around 15%, which increased to 51% as of now. Also, we have started with Cooperative Societies Act that talks about forming of cooperative societies for giving agricultural credits. Also, this brought in institutional inadequacies. There were issues related to the infrastructure, and the Bihar issue, the Bihar drought that came in 1965 to 67 was one of the leading reasons which led to nationalization of the banks. And later on, you had the regional rural banks, which established as an alternative to the main banking system in 1980s. Later on, establishment of NABARD took place. So this is something that we have already covered in detail in our classes on economics. The idea was the reforms of 1991 basically brought in a deregulation of the interest income. There was a recapitalization of the regional rural banks that was seen, and there were numerous schemes like interest subvention scheme. You had Pradhan Mantri Kisan Credit Card Yojana, प्रधानमंत्री कृषि किसान सम्मान योजना. सो दोज आर सम ऑफ द रीसेंट स्कीम्स दैट केम अप. बट द ओवरऑल आइडिया वॉज टू ब्रिंग इन मोर डेवलपमेंट फॉर द फार्मिंग सेक्शन. द नेक्स्ट इज वैक्सीनेशन. नाउ वैक्सीनेशन हैज बिकम वन ऑफ द की इशूज एज ऑफ नाउ. द रीजन बींग दिस हैज बीन द वर्स्ट हिट पैंडमिक दैट हैज बीन सीन ओवर द ईयर्स. एंड इबोला वॉज वन ऑफ द डिजीजेज फॉर विच द फास्टेस्ट वैक्सीन कुड हैव बीन क्रिएटेड इन अ पीरियड ऑफ 4 years. हाउएवर there were numerous side effects that were seen. So vaccines have a role, but they are not the only and only way to rule out the disease from the system. India's GDP had been declining significantly, and therefore we are, as other countries are, rushing towards a vaccination system. But this vaccination system, we are really not sure would be a successful vaccination system, because usually a good vaccine takes around 10 to 12 years to come up, and with this shorter duration of time period, we can see there has been a significant changes in the systems that could be witnessed. We have leading companies like AstraZeneca. Then you have the companies which are working for COVID vaccination. But India's Serum Institute, the Serum Institute, which is one of the leading producers of vaccinations in India, the vaccines in India, in terms of volume, not only in India but across the globe, has been working with Oxford University and AstraZeneca project, and they are working on the phase 3 human trials as of now. Now, during this time of COVID, we have seen a lot of terms like positivity rate coming up. What is positivity rate? Positivity rate, if I'm saying a low positivity rate, it means the testing levels are sufficient for scaling the epidemic, and a kind of surveillance that could penetrate at the community level to detect the resurgence of a disease. However, if I'm talking about higher positivity level, this indicates that the testing is limited to, is done to a limited group of people, and might be we are missing any kind of new chains of transmissions that could be there. So over the time period, we have seen lots of rates coming up, and positivity rate is one of those, so you need to know about it. The next is environmental impact assessment. Now the draft 2020 is already there, but let's first understand what it is all about and why do we need actually an environmental impact assessment. So environmental impact assessment is nothing but it talks about a balance between environment and development, and this works on a cost benefit analysis. So working towards which project should be done, at what pace they should be completed. So we had the first environmental impact assessment that was done in 1986, followed by 2006, and then a revision after nearly a period of 14 years in 2020, where the draft bill is there. And the idea is, we are talking about suggestions from common people. There have been nearly 1.7 million suggestions, and those have been forwarded to NERI Nagpur for analysis. Now, what actually occurs under an environmental impact assessment? You have category A and category B. Category A, the projects are being dealt with the center. Category B, the projects are being dealt with the state. So this is the exact numbers that are there, the number of projects that are there under the 2006. However, under 2020, we are trying to increase the total projects to 110, of which we would be focusing on category A with nearly 39 projects, and category B1 with 42 projects, and B2 with 29 projects. The idea is, we are focusing on more and more projects to be taken into account, but the number of projects more or less remain the same. The idea is, the major breakup has been done across the category. So let's say thermal, solar, all of those were in one category. So now they are lying in different categories. So we have an overall count that has increased by the number. Now, B1 category, A, as we already know, is by center. B is by state. So B1 is which requires environmental impact assessment, and B2 is which do not require a EIA. Now, again, the project talks about the clearances from the various level, but if anything, any of the parcel of land is required, let's say for strategic purpose, no public consultation would be done, and the land would be directly acquired, and whatever project needs to be done would be done. So that is one of the major changes that we have seen. Also, there is a kind of 4-stage approval regime that is seen, which includes the appraisal and the public consultation, which is important and mandatory. Now, if we talk about the differences, as we have seen in the two categories, the 2006 report does not talks about any exemptions. However, 40 projects have complete exemption under 2020. Now, there has been a serious debate talking about the harms of the changing EIA, and this could be detrimental to environment by many of the environmentalists, as they quote. Now, the time for the public to respond was 30 days, and now it is 20 days proposed. Also, the exemption from public consultation was only in the areas of the projects going for higher capacity or production building. However, here we have only up to 50% increase in the capacity. If we are working till that, no public consultation is required, and there is no provision for the post facto clearance in the case of the previous bill. However, now you would have a daily fine that would be there. Now, many of the projects, let's say widening of the highway from 25 kilometers to 100 kilometers, construction of aerial ropeways, exploration of onshore, offshore oil drilling platforms are some of the examples which have now been shifted to category A. Also, we have seen significant unit advancements under various categories. So the clauses that come under the EIA are important, so that we would cover in a separate lecture. Also, we have covered a separate lecture on environmental impact assessment in detail. So just go through that for more information. The next is Rauta village. Now, this is a village which lies in the Nazafgarh region, and it's on the Delhi-Haryana border in the southwest region. Sahibi river, which was previously called as, and now it is a Nazafgarh drain. Nearly most of the village is being submerged with knee length water, and that is the wastewater. So the wetlands are turning into wastelands, and there is where we have a significant shrinking of the wetland that has been seen from 220 square kilometers to only 7 square kilometers. Also, in Delhi, we have seen a lot of villages that were part of Delhi during the independence, nearly 360 villages, of which only 112 remain. The rest have been subsumed under the Delhi Development Authority. Also, Delhi Nagar Swaraj Bill has proposed Mohalla Sabhas for the provisions under the Panchayati Raj, and most of the villages are now part of the municipality. So, the Delhi Village Board has replaced the Delhi Rural Village Board as of the legal issues if we talk about. Now, coal and the carbon emissions related to it are very, very important. On one hand, across the globe, think tanks are working towards curbing the carbon emission, reducing the carbon. However, we have seen there has been a significant increase in the carbon. Now, Japan is the sixth most polluting nation and says that it does not have enough renewable power. So, it's starting up with new coal plants. Similar is the case with China, which already has an installed capacity of nearly 970 gigawatts, and it's trying to bring another 200 gigawatts of coal energy. But they are trying to provide financial and technical support to other nations who are trying to move towards a renewable source of energy. Similarly, in European Union, Germany is one of the biggest contributors. Also, countries like Japan, Norway are funding a lot to other countries for basically moving towards other industries and also towards the exploration industries. But the sole idea is the carbon footprint needs to be decreased, and if each of the countries progress in the same fashion, it would be very, very difficult. Countries like Indonesia and Australia are the world's biggest coal exporters as of now, and Joe Biden, who is targeting for the US elections, has proposed that a carbon-free power energy system would come up by 2035. Similarly, we are trying to move towards reducing the global climate or the global temperatures, we could say, to pre-industrial level, 1.5 degrees Celsius, as it has been quoted. Now, similarly, we have talked about a lot of solid waste management and the issues related to waste. Kashmir is no exception. Srinagar is among the 100 fastest growing urban centers in India, and most of the area is mountainous. You have only few areas where you can have settled and systematic lifestyle that could be seen. The Karewas, which are the fertile hilly lands, have lakes that are seen. and they are good regions for agriculture. But over the years, we have seen that the wetlands are turning into wasteland, as the case of the Rauta village that we have talked about in the region of Delhi. Bandipur Municipal Corporation has adopted a similar method where you have the Ningli water wetland areas along the Wooler Lake, which are significantly affected by dumping of the waste. And the local authorities are not at all serious about the issue. The next important topic that we would focus on is the Panama disease of banana. Now, banana is one of the world's oldest domesticated crop. From the two wild varieties, it all started. And then you had one of the sailor who took some of the bananas from Jamaica to Panama. And there, when he saw the banana plantation was turning yellowish, and it was believed that there was the disease that started to spread. And there is why the name Panama disease came in. However, it was first in the recent times reported in Taiwan 50 years back, and since then it has been spreading all around to Asia, Australia, Africa and so on. We have nearly 65% of the total variety, which is Cavendish. Then we have 20% traditional and nearly 320 other small varieties that are seen. Most of 80% of the varieties are susceptible to this banana disease, Panama disease. However, in the south you have the Nindra and red banana, which are not affected by the TR4, which is the fungus strain that has been seen for race 1. Also, we have seen that there has been the infection that varies. For example, the G9 crop has seen an infection which talks about the plant not able to withstand heavy rains, water conditions, winds. But the other varieties like Chini Kela, Padma 1, Padma 2, the traditional varieties are able to withstand that. And also the traditional varieties do not break that easily and not worse affected by the Panama disease as the G9 varieties. Then we have seen that there has been a significant spread of the disease. Now, how it occurs, it is basically a fungus. So the spore could be in the farmer's shoes, it could be in any of the equipments of farm, and if even one spore is found, it is capable of infecting one tree, and it can be there for a period of 40 years. So it is highly invasive, and bananas, it is believed, are on the verge of extinction if it goes on. Most of the lands, mainly in the region of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh in India, have been worstly affected by it. We have seen a significant losses that have been registered in these regions, and it's believed that if it is not curtailed as of now, this issue is going to bring a significant loss to nearly $25 billion industry, which is a significant banana industry proportion that is seen. So definitely there has to be steps that need to be taken into account, and revival of banana is important. So there have been various methods that are used. For example, in India, we are trying to work on another fungus which acts as a biofungicide, and it inhibits the growth of the hyphae of the existing T4 strain. So it brings in kind of antifungal chemicals which inhibit the growth. Similarly, we have various methods that are being used by various countries. China is using chemical mutagenesis, which includes use of chemicals, gammas, x-rays to bring in random mutations. Philippines is talking about gamma irradiation that is there. Similarly, US is trying about gene editing. Dole Food is one of the major suppliers of banana across the globe, and it is talking about gene editing crops. The major producers are the Latin American region and the Caribbean region. And the exports mainly go to United States and European Union. So there have been various efforts going on in different parts of the world where we are trying to bring in varieties which are much more resistant, but still, commercial plants, since they are genetically identical, they cannot defend themselves against the Panama disease. So what is being done or what is being planned is the technique of gene slicing, gene editing, might be cloning, and creating artificial ways through which this pathogen could be knocked out. But still, as we could understand, the crop is at a significant threat that could be seen in the coming years. So those was about the, some of the major headlines from the Down to Earth edition. We would be covering many more interesting topics for you. Stay tuned. Have a wonderful day ahead.